Well, good morning. It's a beautiful morning this morning, isn't it? It's great to be here this morning, and I just encourage you as we sing the first song this morning. The first song is called Here I Am to Worship. So as we worship the Lord, just examine your heart and come before the Lord this morning.
Take a moment and greet one another. This morning on Memorial Day weekend, as we come and we have a chance to remember and reflect on the sacrifice of so many who have died to protect our freedom and our liberties. And we do grieve with those who have lost loved ones and are filled with gratitude for their giving of their lives to protect these very freedoms, the opportunity to worship, to come together and praise the Lord this morning especially. And as we look at Jesus, as we celebrate him this morning, he is the ultimate sacrifice that was given for us, and we come to celebrate that this morning the opportunity to come before the Lord like this. We want to welcome those that are visiting with us this morning. It's so good to have you here. Just a couple of things. If you have any prayer requests, we just encourage you to grab one of the blue cards in the pew rack in front of you. We'd love to be able to pray for you. We pray for you as a staff, as a church family. And also, if you would like any information on the back side of that card, just jot down some contact information. We'd love to be able to get back in touch with you if you're looking for any information about ministries here, what we're doing within the church, or just about the church in general. Also, we have a website, lfc.org, which some are probably streaming this morning, so I want to welcome you if you're streaming with us online. It's great to have you joining us in worship as well. We have a welcome center in the back where there's more information for you if you're looking to get plugged in any way, or I'll mention some signups later during our announcement time, and that's where you'd go to take care of any signups that we have. Also, we have some children's ministries that I wanted to make you aware of. The nursery ministry is down in room 205 down the hallway. And downstairs, we have our junior church ministry for children ages 3 to 6. So just want to, right before the sermon, you'll be dismissed to go down for that ministry. Also, if you have anything else, any other needs that come up during the service, I would just encourage you to slip into the back, and one of our ushers would be glad to assist you this morning. In the bulletin, we have a few announcements that I'd like to highlight for you. First, our summer prayer meetings are going to be Wednesday mornings at 9:30 in the fellowship room off the kitchen. And also, just to mention, June 10th is going to be a very busy day in this area. There's lots going on, but I want to mention that we have two things specifically that LFC will be part of that day. The first is the Lafayette Day, which takes place at Lafayette Park. And it's a great opportunity to be in the community, be a blessing to the community. And so we are going to be sponsoring a children's bounce house. Now, notice I did say children's bounce house. We've had some adults wondering, you know, can we get in there? But it's going to be for children, as much as we'd love to get in there. But we just want to offer that. So bring your families, drop on by. We'll also provide water. We'll have just some information available from the church there. And hopefully we'll have the opportunity to share the gospel with some from our community right here in Lafayette. So just want to encourage you, make sure you're aware of that. Also, Faith and Family Day is that night. You'll notice the top box there is highlights that top middle box. Tickets are still available. I think they're going to be ordering them this week, so make sure you get your requests in. We'd love to be able to have you join us. There's going to be an LFC section there so to support the minors and to be able to have a great time together as a church. Also, the combined worship services are going to be starting on July 2nd. So they'll run July 2nd for 4th July weekend, and it will go all the way through Labor Day. So Labor Day will be our final Sunday where we'll have the combined services. So a lot of information, a lot more information that's available here. But like I mentioned earlier, take a look through, see if there's anything else that you'd like to get plugged in on. One other thing I'll mention is Vacation Bible School. We have that. We have registration forms in the back on that. So please, you know, fill that out and drop that off right there at the Welcome Center. And as I mentioned earlier, we're here to celebrate the sacrifice of Jesus and worship him and lift his name on high. So at this time, I'm going to invite everyone to stand this morning as we have the opportunity to say our verse together this morning. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. 1 John 3:16. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you so much for this opportunity you've given us to gather as your body and worship you. We pray, Lord, that we would worship you in spirit and in truth this morning, declare your praises, and honor you in everything we say and we do. Pray this in your son's precious name. Amen. Thank you.
Please be seated.
Lord, we thank you that you are present because you dwell in the hearts of your children. And so we thank you for your presence with us. And more than that, Lord, we thank you that you never leave us, you never forsake us, Lord. Father, this morning as a church family, we come before you and Lord, we lift up each other and pray for each other as the body of Christ. Lord, we know that there are people here, probably, Lord, every single one of us gathering together with unspoken needs and hurts and fears, Lord, and we pray right now for each other. Lord, we pray that you would meet every need that's unspoken. We pray that you would bless and guide and direct those who are seeking your guidance and direction in their lives. Lord, we pray that you would fill those with joy who are mourning, and Lord, those who are in celebration, that we would be reminded of the need of others that are less fortunate. So, Father, we pray again in all ways we would be a true family of faith. Lord, this morning as the family of faith, we celebrate and are so grateful for a new life, Lord. We pray and we just celebrate with Justin and Courtney Garris at the birth of their new little girl, Lacey Faye. And, Father, we celebrate this new life and thank you for this wonderful family. And we pray your blessing over Courtney and over this precious little baby and Justin and the rest of the family, Lord. What a blessing. Thank you for this new life. Father, we celebrate with Will and Jillian Hill on the birth of their baby boy, Levi. And again, Lord, we thank you for this wonderful family and ask that you would be with Jillian and this precious new little boy and that family. We celebrate as that family celebrates, Lord. What a blessing and what a joy to have those additions to this new these new additions to this family of faith here, Lord. Lord, we also celebrate with Nick and Jenna Van Borum, who were married a few weeks ago and are back from their honeymoon. And we pray that you would bless their marriage and we pray that you would bless their lives together. May they serve you and may they grow in their love for each other as they grow in their love and commitment to you, Lord. We pray and thank you for that new marriage. Father, this morning we pray for our juniors and seniors who are gone on a trip this weekend, and we ask that you'd bless them. We ask that you'd give them a wonderful day of fellowship today, and that they would be encouraged in their faith, Lord, that they would grow closer together as brothers and sisters in Christ. We pray for safe travel back tomorrow. And again, we pray and thank you for our junior and seniors who are gone this weekend, Lord. Father, we pray this week also for our church ministry that we are focusing on the men's Bible study. We pray that you'd bless that group of men as they meet. We pray that as iron sharpens iron, they would sharpen each other, encourage each other towards godliness, Lord. We pray that you'd bless that ministry, grow that, Father, not only numerically, but help them to grow deeper in their love and their faith in you, Lord. Father, we pray for our missionaries of the week, Ralph and Anula Jacques, with Eagles of Peace as they serve in the Middle East. And Lord, we love and appreciate Ralph and Anula so much, and we pray for their safety. We pray for their effectiveness. We pray for their family. And Lord, we know they serve in a very difficult, dangerous place in the world, so we ask that you would use them and that they would be a shining light in a very, very dark place, Lord. So we pray for your blessings over Ralph and Anula. And Father, we also this morning pray for our sister church in the community, Highlands Bible Church, and Pastor Mike Rule and his wife Melanie and their family. And Lord, we just praise and celebrate as they have moved into a new building. And we ask that you would bless them as they fix it up and renovate and get ready for services there. And Lord, we pray that that building would be just a real vital tool that you will use to help them to reach this entire community, this county for you, Lord. We pray that you would bless their services this morning. We pray that you'd strengthen them in the midst of much hard work. And again, Lord, we ask that you would use them to reach people for Christ. Lord, we pray that that church would grow, and we pray that they would continue to expand your kingdom in Sussex County and beyond, Father. Lord, we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to give our tithes and offerings this morning, and we do pray a blessing over each offering that is given. Lord, we pray that you would use it to further your kingdom and for your glory. And Lord, we do finally this morning do deeply thank you, and we want to honor those who have given their lives over hundreds of years of this nation's history. And Lord, we recognize that all freedom is ultimately from you, but Lord, we recognize that the men and women of our military who have given their lives were your tools to preserve and to keep this freedom that we have. And so, Lord, we honor them this morning, and we thank you, Father, as a church. We thank you as a nation. We thank you as individuals for their great sacrifice. Lord, thank you that their sacrifice is a reflection of your ultimate sacrifice, Jesus, that you made for us. And I pray that not only would we follow the example of those men and women who have given their lives, but ultimately follow your example in giving ourselves fully to each other for the cause of freedom, not only political freedom, but most certainly freedom in Christ, freedom from sin, freedom to have hope in you, Christ alone. Lord, we love you. We thank you for that freedom this morning. And it is in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen.
For my comrades who have fallen, for those who have gone before, for my country that was lifted on their shoulders in every war, if I have one request, yes, just one I ask of you, it's that you stand with me now, stand, remember, and renew. Stand with those that are now serving, remember the soldiers of the past. Renew your commitment to freedom, for they have died to make it last. Every battle has its reasons, though they may not always be clear. And I can state that boldly, even through my tears. Too many soldiers have fallen in the battles, sieges, and fights. I will not forget them today. I will remember them all through the night. Lester L. Arrowsmith, Colonel, United States Air Force.
Certainly is a good weekend to reflect, a good weekend to remember, and a good weekend to be reminded that freedom certainly does come with a cost. And it's a good weekend for us to remember to not only thank the Lord for the sacrifice made by many in giving of their lives, but also a wonderful reminder for us to pray diligently for those who are serving currently in the military. Many of your family members are serving, extended family and friends, and what a good reminder to us to pray for those who are serving us faithfully. We are so thankful for their sacrifice, as well as the sacrifice made by those of you who are their family members. That's a difficult calling, but one that is worthy. Well, let's pray and ask the Lord this morning as we open up His Word to speak to us and to challenge us as we finish up this wonderful book of 1 Corinthians. Heavenly Father, we thank You. Lord, we thank You for this weekend. What a blessing. What a time to reflect and to remember, Lord. And we do thank You for the freedom that we have to open Your Word this morning. Lord, we know there are many brothers and sisters across the world who do not have the freedom to gather, the freedom to openly proclaim the Word, to pray, to worship. And so, Lord, we are very, very grateful and very humbled, Lord. We know that You don't love us more. We know that we don't have greater value. We realize, though, Lord, we are deeply blessed. And we pray for those brothers and sisters across the world who don't have that freedom, but who are gathered today. Bless them, and Lord, protect them and watch over them. Lord, this morning we thank You for Your Word, and Lord, we thank You for this book of 1 Corinthians, and Lord, as we wrap this up, Lord, may we not just move on from the truth of this wonderful book of the Bible, but may we apply it to our lives every day as the body of Christ. Lord, bless the preaching of Your Word, Lord. May we apply every word of this Scripture to our lives this morning. And it is in Jesus' precious name that we pray. Amen. Well, if you would, turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, and we end this wonderful book with a greeting, which is very common in Paul's writings. It was very common in Middle Eastern writing of that day in the ancient world to begin a letter with a very brief greeting, get to the point, and then finish the letter with an extensive and final greeting. And so this morning we see Paul really wrapping up his final words that he has to say to the Corinthian church. And this letter has been kind of a rocky road. We've seen a church that has been in tumult. We've seen a church that struggled with disunity and false teaching. They've been fighting amongst one another. They've been abusing their gifts. And so Paul has really, in this magnificent letter, straightened them out, ultimately for the purpose of them, as we said at the very beginning, of being the body of Christ. It's a reminder to us that it is a unique thing that we're a part of. That as the body of Christ, as the church, we're more than an organization. We're more than a gathering of people. We are God's called out ones. And every one of us is here purposefully. If God has called you to be a part of this church, God has a plan for you to be used, using your gifts, your talents, your abilities, your background to serve Him, to further His kingdom through the church. We're reminded that the end goal of the body of Christ, the church, is not for us to grow as a local body of believers, but the purpose of the church is to be a tool that God uses to expand His kingdom. And so we celebrate the fact that each one of us gathers together with a purpose. And ultimately, that purpose is as I think the theme of 1 Corinthians has been from the beginning to the end, by being a healthy, loving, growing, God-honoring body of Christ. And so Paul comes to the very end of this letter, and he has what we would say his final words. And I don't know about you, but I listen to final words. I often sit back and daydream about what my final words would be if I would have the opportunity to utter final words. I've always dreamed of being a very old man in the pulpit, either talking about heaven or hell, either one, and then dying of a heart attack. You would never forget my final words, would you? You would tell your grandkids would say, I was just a kid, but I remember this pastor who died in the pulpit, but his final words were about heaven, about eternity. I've often joked that I'd like my tombstone to say, here lies Aaron Robb, and in quotes, I told you I was sick. Something like that on my gravestone. Final words. Well, Paul here gives us his final words, the final words to the Corinthian church. And of course, not his ultimate final words. He hoped to visit. He would visit. There were more letters to come. But he wraps up this very powerful letter with what I see as five words of encouragement, five examples to follow, but ultimately one principle by which to live. Let's look this morning as we close out this letter at the five words of encouragement that Paul gives to the Corinthian church and the Holy Spirit gives us as we read this letter, as we apply it to our lives. And these five words of encouragement are found in verses 13 and 14. Paul says, "Be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be courageous, be strong, do everything in love." So in these opening verses that we look at this morning, Paul gives five words of encouragement. And these five words, these little phrases, are all in the present imperative, which means they are not optional. They are imperative. They are commands. And they are in the present tense, which means there's something that we should do every day, that we should practice in an ongoing manner. And the first four commands are actually military metaphors. They are military language. And so Paul is emphasizing the importance, the resoluteness that these commands, these words of encouragement should take on. First of all, he says this, that we as the church should be on guard. And this is a word of warning that Paul is giving to watch out for those who would seek to bring division. If you'll remember, the entire theme throughout this magnificent book has been, don't be divided as the body, but be unified in our gifts, be unified in our doctrine, be unified in our practice, be unified in how we serve one another. And he's not only talking about being on guard, but he's specifically mentioning being on guard within the body of Christ. Because even as persecution was beginning to come in the culture against the church in Corinth, you'll notice that their greatest danger was still on the inside. And I would say that that is true, certainly, of the modern American church, that the danger from without is very minimal compared to the danger that we need to be on guard against within the body. Within the body, we need to be on guard of false teachings. Within the body, we need to be on guard against factions, against favoritism, against all of those things that can divide a family of the faith. Now, this expression, be on guard, is also used by Paul elsewhere and is used throughout the New Testament also to speak of anticipation about the Lord's coming. And that might have been what Paul is talking about as well. Be on guard. His point is probably be on guard because as the family of faith, we don't want anything to divide us, and be on guard because we know that Jesus is coming back. And how we act and our behavior as the body of Christ should represent a body ready for His return. So he says, be on guard. Secondly, he encourages us to stand firm in the faith. And this is a direct military term from the culture, and it literally means to hold their ground, to not retreat before an enemy. And so he's saying, be firm, stand guard. He's saying, be resolute, don't be moved, hold your ground in your faith. And likely Paul is speaking here both of general doctrine. He's saying, be on guard, stand firm, don't give ground on what is being taught. Don't let false doctrine slip into the church. And you remember that was one of the key issues with the church in Corinth. There were those who had slipped into the church that were teaching that there was an experience higher and more mystical to experience God above and beyond the gospel in Jesus. And so Paul is likely here reminding them, as we were reminded, that there is nothing deeper than the gospel. There is no way that you can have a deeper relationship with God than through Jesus, through a daily growing, deepening love relationship with Jesus. He's saying, church, stand firm. Make sure what is taught is true. And then he's encouraging the individuals. You stand firm as well in your walk. Don't be swayed. Stand firm. Next he says, and I kind of lump these two together because most often in the Bible, these two phrases are used together. He says, next, be courageous and be strong. Be strong and be courageous. And these are often in the Bible, all the way back to the Old Testament, used together. They're grouped to encourage God's people to have courage in the face of danger, even and especially in the face of enemies. Now, it's very interesting that Paul specifically, when he says, be strong, in the original language, uses the passive voice. In other words, if this was translated most directly from the Greek, he would be saying, be strengthened. And isn't that telling? Be strong almost sounds like we need to manufacture the strength, right? But what Paul is actually saying is be strengthened. He's reminding us that our strength to be the body of Christ, to do all of these things that we've been talking about through this book for the last year and a half, ultimately comes from the empowering presence of the Lord. We can't be the body of Christ on our own. We need the strengthening and the help of the Lord. We can't stand firm against false teaching and false practices without the empowering presence of the Holy Spirit. Be strengthened. This is also a great word of encouragement to us because it's a reminder that we're not called to do this on our own. That we're never called to face anything that we need courage and strength for on our own. And that applies to your personal life, whatever you're going through, the struggles and the trials that you're facing. Be reminded by the scripture this morning, you don't face that alone. You don't walk through the battle on your own. That you are strengthened. There is an outside source of help. We're reminded that we can't do the Lord's work without the Lord's empowering. General George Patton summed it up well. He was famous for saying, courage is fear that has said its prayers. Let's be reminded that we are to be courageous and strong, the Bible says, but we do that with the strength of the Lord. And then finally, in verse 14, Paul says this, do everything in love. And we're going to come back to that because it's very interesting. Paul really bookends these final words with this concept of love. And I don't want to spend too much time on it right now, but be reminded, verse 14 says, do everything in love. And then look all the way down at verse 24. He ends it with a word of love. My love to all of you in Christ Jesus. Amen. And so we see ultimately that the greatest command is to love. But we're going to come back and really wrap this up because I believe this concept of love is what undergirds not only this entire book, but certainly these final greetings. So Paul, first of all, gives five words of encouragement. Five words, he says, be on your guard, stand firm in the faith, be courageous, be strong, and do everything in love. He moves from some words of encouragement and some commands to then some examples to follow. So Paul really wraps up this letter with some personal greetings and some personal mentions of some people. And we see in the midst of Paul mentioning some of these people and acquaintances of both him and of the Corinthian church that these just aren't side notes. As with everything in the Bible, this is completely inspired. The Holy Spirit had a purpose and a plan. And that plan, I believe, is for us to look at the lives of these people that Paul mentions and follow their example. He basically, through giving the example of these people, gives what I think are five examples of spiritual maturity. And each one of these, interestingly, are wrapped up in relationship. And we're reminded again that 1 Corinthians has all been about being the body, a healthy body of Christ. And so let's look at these five basic examples to follow to grow in spiritual maturity. He says, first of all, in verse 15, "You know that the household of Stephanas were the first converts in Achaia, and they have devoted themselves to the service of the Lord's people." So the first example to follow is the example of service. We've been given five commands, and he closes now with five examples for us as the body of Christ. And number one is the example of service. So we know that Stephanas and his family were Paul's first converts in Achaia, and that was the province where Corinth was. And so in essence, this was the family. These were the people who first came to know Christ through Paul in Corinth, in that region. They'd given themselves, obviously, selflessly in the service of the Lord and serving the Corinthians. They're probably very loyal to Paul, and we think likely that they were the ones who probably let Paul know about all of the issues and the problems that were going on in the Corinthian church. So this was really his source of information about the brokenness in the Corinthian church. Verse 15 says they devoted themselves to the service of the Lord's people. Now, any of you that are using the King James Version this morning will note this, that the translators of the King James translates the verb we have in the NIV, devoted, as addicted. And so some of your translations talk about them being addicted to service. I like that. I like the picture of someone, of a family, serving so consistently the needs of others that they're identified as being addicted. They were hooked on serving. That's not such a bad addiction, is it? It beats carbs, it beats sugar and other things. The challenge is this, and I would encourage you to look at yourself and simply ask yourself the question, could you be accused of being addicted to serving? Some of you could be. Some of you are such great and faithful servants. You're a challenge to the rest of us to say, how can I serve more? I think one of the greatest ways that we could be identified as a believer in Jesus is someone who serves and meets the needs of others. There is no greater way to spend your life than in the service of the Lord and serving other people. So the first example to follow is service. The second example to follow is submission. Look at verse 16. Verse 16 says, and we'll back up in the last part of verse 15, "I urge you, brothers and sisters, to submit to such people and to everyone who joins in the work and the labors at it." Now, the Corinthians, if they had an issue, as we learned as we've gone through this book, is they had an issue with submission. They didn't follow leadership well. They certainly didn't follow Paul's leadership. They were a rebellious bunch. They were stubborn. They could be very arrogant at times. Many people in the church did their own thing, no matter what those in leadership said. Now, these verses would be a reminder to them to appreciate and to follow the example and even submit to those who had earned that place through service. Notice that there's no note here that Stephanas and his family that Stephanas was a pastor or an elder. He had, in Paul's eyes, earned the calling to be followed and submitted to out of his servant's heart, out of his depth of character, out of his service to the Lord. Let's be reminded, church, that at the heart of what it means to be the body and to relate to one another is mutual submission. Paul would say in his letter to the Ephesians that we are to submit to one another. that as the body of Christ, we submit to each other out of love. We submit to each other in service. We submit to each other as a way to honor the Lord. And I would challenge you with this question. Not only do you serve, but secondly, do you have a submissive heart? Do you submit in your mind and in your heart, not only to the leaders of the church, but do you submit to others? Do you serve one another as a calling? Are you willing to put the good of the other person above yourself? I would say a good metaphor, or excuse me, a good synonym for submit in this case might also be honor. Do you go out of your way to find ways to honor each other, to esteem each other? So we have the first example of service, the second example of submission. Next, in verse 17, we have the example to follow of friendship. Verse 17, I was glad when Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus arrived, because they have supplied what was lacking from you. For they, I love this, for they refreshed my spirit and yours also. Such men deserve recognition. So apparently what was going on was, when the financial support for Paul's missionary work dried up, Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaicus bailed him out. They came up with the money. We don't know if it was their personal money, if they took a collection from the churches. But even more than meeting Paul's financial needs, look at that phrase. He said that they refreshed his spirit. I think one of the greatest compliments we could give each other is that we refresh each other's spirit. I would challenge you to really look at your life, how you live within the body of Christ. And I'd simply challenge you to ask yourself this question: are you one who refreshes others? In other words, once you come in a room, a meeting, and a Bible study, when you just gather together in the coffee fellowship room, when you get together in shepherding groups, when you come together, are you a person who always feels, that makes everyone feel better for being around you? Are you a blessing to everyone with whom you have contact? Let me ask you this. When you enter a room, especially in the body of Christ, is there more joy, more peace, more love than when you arrived? When you leave that room, is the atmosphere, is the attitude better? Do you refresh your fellow believers, or do you bring them down? And then let me ask you this. When you receive refreshing from another brother or sister, how do you respond? How do you respond to those who are a blessing to you? Paul here says that such people deserve recognition. And Paul here in the Greek is not saying they deserve to have a ceremony or a parade. It's not the idea that we need to print their names in the bulletin and bring them up. That idea of recognition really carries the idea of thanking them, of us recognizing what a blessing they are, and then in return being a blessing to them. I think the best way to express that is simply this. For those who are a blessing to you in the body of Christ, why don't you write them a note? Why don't you give them a call? When you see them in the hall, hug them and tell them what they mean to you. There's nothing more powerful and encouraging and humbling than for someone to come up and simply tell you how you have blessed them and what you've meant to them. Isn't that the picture of Christian friendship? Isn't that the example we're to follow? I'm really amazed a lot of times, and I've had this many times as a pastor. Dana and I talk about this a lot, where people will come to us, and occasionally, in every church we've served at, will come and they will say, oh, we like the worship service, we in general like the church, but we're not making friends in the church. And the first assumption is that on their part is that it's the church's fault. And I will say, there's always a necessity for us as the church to make sure we're friendly, that we put things in place to encourage us all to greet new people, to invest in them. But what I, quite frankly, have found most of the time is that many, And I, again, would say most people who say they're having a hard time making friends in the church, especially a church like this, is because they haven't taken the extra step to invest in something like a small group, a Sunday school class, a shepherding group. The reality is that this type of Christian friendship that Paul is talking about really is a two-way investment. Church, you and I must go out of our way, and I would encourage you, and I think we do most of the time. So this is a word of encouragement, but also just a reminder to us. We must, when we gather together, always be seeking out the person who looks like they're new, or the person who looks like they're lonely. That it's you and I that should individually take the initiative when we see someone look like they're wandering around having no idea where they're at, to go and introduce ourselves, to say, can I help you find something? It's our job as believers established in the church to invest in new people, in guests, to invest in those who may have been coming for years but who are on the fringe. But I would encourage you, if you're here, and maybe you're one of those people who for months and maybe years have kind of existed on the fringe, and maybe you're here saying, oh, this, I don't know, this church is fine, but I don't have many friendships. I don't know how friendly people really are. Can I encourage you for you also to take the step? I'd encourage you to go to a Sunday school class this morning. Ask somebody at the Welcome Center. Ask a pastor, what's a class that I could go to? When we talk about shepherding groups that meet on the first Sunday of each month, they're just groups that are intended to be times of fellowship and prayer. That's all that they are, for the purpose of people getting connected. When it gets close to the first Sunday, which is next Sunday, I'd encourage you to find a shepherding group. You can find a little slip on the Welcome Center that tells you what the groups are, but even better than that, contact the church office, contact a pastor, give me a call. I'd be glad to encourage you to find a shepherding group and maybe show you one that you would fit in well. At the end of this service, if you're the person that's on the fringe, I encourage you, go find somebody that you don't know and introduce yourself. I think the key to this, and we see this in the life of Stephanas, in the life of Fortunatus and Achaicus, that they invested in Paul. And if we want to experience this type of friendship, we need to invest in each other. And so Paul says, here are the examples: serve, submit. Friendship is the key. And then the fourth example to follow is that of hospitality. Look at verse 19. The churches in the province of Asia send you greetings. Aquila and Priscilla greet you warmly in the Lord, and so does the church that meets in their house. Now, look at that little phrase, that meets in their house. We know, obviously, Aquila and Priscilla opened their homes. They hosted a church. But did you know, according to the New Testament, if you look at the book of Acts and read through all of Paul's writings, that this dynamic ministry couple lived in at least three different cities? They lived in Corinth, they lived in Ephesus, and they lived in Rome. And did you know, in all three cities, they opened their home up for a church to meet? A matter of fact, it was their home that Paul stayed in during his very first visit in Corinth, probably for more than a year and a half. And I would encourage you, there is no greater tool for Christian ministry than your home. And can I encourage you? You can use your home, you can be hospitable, and it doesn't have to be by hosting large groups of people. You can use your home to invite a couple over that maybe just got married and you want to encourage. Or when you meet a guest or someone who's just been coming to the church for a short amount of time, invite them to your house for dinner. Your house doesn't have to be immaculate. Pick the dirty socks up off the floor, okay? But other than that, it doesn't have to be perfectly decorated. People aren't looking for a palace to connect in. They're looking for a real place where people will show them love and hospitality. I would encourage you, find ways to use your home to invest and to show hospitality. Hospitality is actually one of the most important examples and marks of maturity and of discipleship that we find in the Bible.
And I would encourage you to find a way to invest yourself to meet the needs of others. And follow the example of Aquila and Priscilla. What a couple. And then finally, we see this example. This is the example of affection. Verse 20 says this, "All the brothers and sisters here send you greetings. Greet one another with a holy kiss." So Paul sees the custom that was really a custom in the Middle East. It wasn't specifically a Christian custom, but a custom in the Middle East of greeting others with a holy kiss. He saw that as a sign of genuine and deep affection. Now the question is, why has that tradition not really continued on from the early history of the church, except with Pete Pallas, who will kiss you every time he sees you? It's the Greek in him, and I love it. I love it. But why has that in general dropped off from the life of the church? Well, we know historically a couple of things happened. First, it faded because it was liable to abuse. Some people in different things we see in church history had trouble distinguishing holy kisses from other kinds of kisses. And anyway, those things often happen. We can take something that is pure and meaningful, and we as human beings can thwart it and mess it up. But secondly, probably what really was the impetus behind the holy kiss going out of style was that, first of all, when you gathered in homes, as was likely happening most of the time in Corinth, it was very normal. Hey, you're in someone's home, you greet each other with a kiss and a hug. But then as churches moved to buildings and home churches became bigger churches and sanctuaries, basically what happened was the intimacy was lost, and the holy kiss probably kind of vanished with this. Now, I am not advocating the return of the holy kiss. The last thing that I want to have happen when I come into this building is Kurt Gawecki coming up and laying a big wet one on my cheek. I really don't want that, Kurt. I really don't. But what I think we have in the essence of the holy kiss is this, an expression of genuine, warm affection. I think in our culture, it could be a hug or like a warm two-handed handshake, an arm around the shoulder, whatever just seems right to you. The point is this, we are more than the church. We even really are more than the body. We are a family of faith. And we need to learn, and people need affection, appropriate, loving affection from brothers and sisters in Christ. In our church that we served at in St. Joseph, I was always the one who would do the announcements, and we'd finish announcements and we would move into the greeting time. And I would occasionally say, greet one another. One time I said, before you sit down, I want you to find 5 people and give them a hug this morning. Well, there was a man in the church who I think it probably wouldn't be over-exaggeration to say he hated my guts. He just despised me. I know, isn't that hard to believe? He just despised me. And he came up to me after one time where I had encouraged everyone to find 5 people to hug. And he came up and said, "Pastor, I hate that hugging. I hate being hugged. I hate that. We need to stop doing that." So for the next 5 weeks in a row, of course, I encouraged everyone to find 10 people to hug before the service was over. 5 weeks in a row, and I upped it to like 10 because I want to make sure he got hugged several times. But you know what happened? You know what happened? At the end of those 5 weeks, that man hated my guts even more. There's no story there. There's no moral. My point is, we need to not be afraid of affection. We need to learn to understand that there really are times and places, there are opportunities for us to appropriately and in a Christ-like way encourage and touch and to show affection to is the love and the connection that this morning that needs a, in air quotes, holy kiss. Who needs a hug? Who do you need Sometimes the greatest expression of affection is simply your care and the time that you spend. So Paul says, follow this example, this beautiful example of the holy kiss. So he's given us five commands or five encouragements. He's given us five examples to follow. And then he wraps up this wonderful book with one principle by which we should live. And I love that this wraps up the entire book of 1 Corinthians. And of course, that principle is the principle of love. He says back in verse 14, do everything in love. Then he goes on to say in verse 21, listen to this personal touch. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. And then he says, if anyone does not love the Lord, let that person be cursed. Come, Lord. Then he gives a word of blessing. The grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. And then in this final expression of genuine love, he says, my love to all of you in Christ Jesus. Amen. This is a big statement. Remember, this was the church who, behind his back, we know as we read in 2 Corinthians, was basically calling Paul, he's big in his letters, but he's nothing in person. This was the church that we will read in 2 Corinthians made fun of his appearance. This is the church who, despite the fact he was the founding apostle, basically said, we don't follow Paul. We won't submit to his teachings. This is the church that was bickering. This was the church that was rejecting the gospel. Yet the final word, the final say of Paul is my love to all of you in Christ Jesus. He gives them the word of blessing, the grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. He encourages them out of love to remember to love the Lord, because he says, let the person be cursed who does not love the Lord. And he makes sure that they know in verse 21, which was very common, but was a sign of his personal investment in love, that he, at least with this one sentence, was writing the greeting in his own hand. Basically, there was a secretary or someone who wrote down all of Paul's letters. And it was very common in the Middle East at that time that when you had a secretary writing word for word what you were saying, that at some point, you would write in your own hand to verify that this was a message from you, to kind of verify who the messenger truly was. It just blows my mind that at the end of all of what we've seen, Paul finishes with the note of love. The reality of this is this, church, that there is one cure for any ill within the body of Christ. The ultimate principle for being the body of Christ is love. It's ultimately love for Jesus. Paul says, if anyone does not love the Lord, let that person be cursed. It's a word of warning. He's really warning those within the church. You're acting in a way that is inconsistent with what it means to love Jesus. He's warning them. So he's saying, first and foremost, the cure for any church ill is to love Jesus supremely. When you and I love Jesus, when our greatest goal and desire is to love Jesus more, when our greatest desire is to grow in our love relationship with Jesus, it doesn't mean that we won't have conflicts and struggles. But ultimately, if every one of us in the body of Christ is seeking more of Jesus, it's amazing how the conflicts, the differences, the challenges can be overcome. Not set aside and ignored, but in Christ they can be overcome. And when we love Jesus supremely, then we will love each other more and more. Jesus said, all men will know that we are his disciples by the love that we have for one another. So what does it mean, church, to be the body of Christ? It means to love Jesus supremely. And because we love Jesus supremely, love each other better and more intentionally to reflect the love that Christ has for us. In essence, to be the body of Christ means to live out the gospel, to recognize that Jesus, out of His great love for us, died for us on the cross, to see that greatest act of love, to draw us to Himself, to love Him more so that we can ultimately love each other, to be transformed by the work and the love and the power of Jesus. I guess that's our greatest prayer, isn't it? That we would love Him more so we could love each other better. As we wrap up this book, I would just encourage us, let's be resolved, ever more resolved, to love Jesus more, to love the gospel, and to love each other. And to be reminded that as wonderful as a church family as we are, and we are, and as well as we love each other, and we do love each other well, that we can never stop and rest where we're at. This is an intentional, daily striving to be and to express the love of Christ as the body more and more, better and better, more intentionally. And so I guess if we could wrap anything up with this good book, let's make sure and be intentional that we are loving Him so we can love each other. And finally, this morning, as we close, if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, can I tell you, He loves you. The Bible says God so loved the world, and you are included in the world, that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have everlasting life. God wants a relationship with you. He loves you. He paid the price for your sin. And if you would like to know more about how to have a relationship with Jesus, we would love at the end of this service, after we're finished singing, we would love those of us who are up front to share with you how you can come to know Jesus and experience His love. We're going to close this morning with a song we sung a few weeks ago, but I think it could be a great theme song for this entire book, and it is We Are the Body of Christ. I'd like Greg, if you would, to come up, and I'd like this for us to be our closing prayer, and I would like for this to be really the expression of what God's Word has taught us over the past year and a half. I'd invite you, if you would, to stand, and let's sing this. And okay, I don't want any of you grumpy old men to get mad at me, but would you take a moment? I'm not going to ask you to hug, but as we close, would you grab the hands of those next to you? Would you grab the hands of those across the aisle? If you don't like holding hands, you're at the wrong place. And if you can, stretch even across the aisles. And let's sing this wonderful song together. And as Greg leads us, let's make this our prayer as we close, as the body of Christ, being one heart and one spirit.
And I want to make one challenge. I'm sorry, Ryan, I need my microphone. I want to make one challenge to you. This song repeats, and we don't repeat well. But I have a dear friend, Cyril German, who's African-American worship pastor who I've had the privilege to work with, and he repeats well. And I always ask him, why do you repeat so well? Because he can take three songs and worship for 45 minutes, and I feel like we're not done. I can take those same three songs and go 10 minutes, and I'm tired of them. He says we repeat well because we take each repeat and we think upon it differently. And I want to challenge you. We're going to repeat the main part of this song four different times. The first time, let's say it. The second time, let's reflect on it. Look internally. Is this what you're doing? Is this who you are? The third time, let's declare it. Individually, we're saying we're going to do this. And the fourth time, as the body of Christ, let's proclaim it.
One heart, one spirit, one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ. To this we give our life. one voice to praise you. We are the body of Christ. One goal, one vision, to see you exalted. We are the body of Christ. One heart, one spirit, one
dismissed. God bless you.